Hey everyone, so in this video I'm just going to go over some more war film from the previous cross-regional war. It's going to be composed of a few different factions that we ended up facing, and I'm just going to go through, I guess, the thought process behind attacking. Now, this person had a drop defense to start, so it made for an easy first win. If you are hiding your defense to start, usually switch back with about 30 seconds left, because no one's really going to go into a raid, or sorry, like a scouting, just before war starting with 30 seconds, because there could be glitches, there could be a variety of different things. The only reason people would go in might be to set their tower team, but I just don't think that it's worth it to possibly give up points to the enemy that easily, or just forget to change it back. Sometimes, you know, people get busy, you might be called away for a quick second, and then all of a sudden your defense is down, and 20 seconds later, you're the first one that's destroyed. So this attack that I just made, I got pretty lucky. Their Priya doesn't hit that hard. I did trigger her to start, which was a mistake, obviously. And that's one of the biggest problems I find when facing Mercer leads, because Mercers have that huge bonus to AP when taking damage, which is often undervalued, and I know why, because it's not a direct calculation like AP on attack. So a huge bonus to AP on attack is plus 10 AP. A very large bonus to AP on attack is plus 8 AP. But if you have a huge bonus to AP when taking damage, if someone attacks you, that does not automatically mean that you get plus 10 AP. It's based on a ratio, basically, of the damage that you end up taking. So the more damage that you take, the more AP that you get, which makes sense, but it's just very difficult to calculate, and to be honest, I'm not personally going to calculate it myself. I'm not exactly sure how damage is calculated in general, but it would just mean that there'd be a lot of calculations where you'd have to take into account if they have a huge bonus to AP when taking damage as a lead skill as well as on their weapon, and calculating out how much AP they gained versus how much HP that they lost, and figure out the percent ratio between the amount of HP that they lost and the amount of HP that they have. And to me, it's just a lot of work. If someone does want to figure this out, I would be more than happy to listen to them as well as go over their data. It's just, I cannot see myself taking the time to do it, but I commend anyone who wants to put in the effort and the time to figure it out. So in war, I actually do recognize a few names of some people who used to be in the same region as me, so it's kind of cool to see where people end up. This attack now going back to war, Aaron lead makes it a bit tanky. We have Angel, who has exhaust, so she helps prevent unnatural AP gain. We have Raven, who prevents normal AP gain because of her elusive ability. We have Princess for power, and we have Aaron as a tank. He also has a pretty good active skill, and he's one of the reasons why I switched to attack up when impaired as a mod on my Priya, for example. But I believe I have an attack up when taunted mod on my Princess, just so that she, whenever she's normalized or taunted by another Princess, she's at least getting an attack boost. In this match that I'm facing off against, there is a Pete lead. It's supposed to be like a fast rushing defense team by having Dr. Stevens there. My Priya was able to rampage, and the amount of damage was enough to kill both Arav as well as Dr. Stevens, and this made for a quick turn two rush finish, and that's the type of goal that I'm going for. You know, I want things fast. Another person who had dropped defense, again, you just want to be careful about that because it's giving away points pretty quickly. Facing off against this team, it's a bit of a tanky defense, but it has a lot of power. By tanky, I mean Pete lead gives 30% HP and defense. We have a Frost, of course, but then we have tunes like Priya, Princess, and Arav. With my attack up when impaired mod, I was able to do a lot of damage right onto Frost as well as onto Arav and Priya. I really enjoy my attack up when impaired mod. I might have to migrate to an attack up when taunted mod just because of the traitor and when he's used on defense. If he rushes, he's able to taunt the enemy for a few turns. So if I had that bonus, I might be able to kill him, which would be an excellent goal to have, because then there's no one taunting my tunes anymore and I'm back in full control. Of course, if I have a focus tune, I don't really have to worry about any taunting abilities. this defensive team. I find them kind of annoying with Angel, especially if I can't control Angel on the first turn. Like right now, I just ended up blowing up my princess by mistake because exhaust was applied. Glenn took 1500 maim damage because Dr. Stevens was hit. And now this match is kind of over for me. There's not much I can do. I got a little lucky with that rampage, but I did lose two toons. I really should have used my other Dr. Stevens team that has an exhaust as well as maim resist on him, because then I wouldn't have as much fear about being able to use him early on and exhausting him. I might still exhaust my other toons on the team, but at least I would have some reassurance. Now, most of the time in matches, I'd probably flee this match, but because I knew I'd be able to use my Priya, I decided to try and test it. Now, I wasn't completely lucky. I'm left with a Mercer. I have three toons left. He's stunned now, but I left it on auto. And because I left it on auto, Mercer ended up using his active skill instead of his rush. So he gave himself elusive and recovered from burn, bleed, maim. I was able to use my Priya to finish it off and got lucky with a double attack. But all I had left was Dr. Stevens. This defensive team, again, I've mentioned this about Jackie leads. If it's not a fast rushing team or has a human shield, like it's not as threatening, I find, because I'm still gaining AP on that first turn. And because of how Mercer works, if I do end up attacking myself, because of that huge bonus to AP when taking damage, I'm probably gaining more AP than what I usually would because my toons are taking damage. Sure, it's friendly fire, but it gives me a higher chance of actually being able to rush. And usually, the more times you rush, the better off you are. Now, of course, it's not ideal attacking myself, but you have to use what you're given, and you have to learn how to leverage what you have. And leveraging what you have is quite difficult because things change so fast, especially with RNG. You never know what's going to happen because the smallest change will mean the biggest difference in the match. And being able to adapt to those changes on the fly is important. Like in a match like this, where all the enemy toons were basically stunned to start, there's no reason why I should command rush Dr. Stevens on the first turn if I'm not going to rush on that first turn. Instead, I saved my rush for the second turn, which means he could rush naturally, and if needed, I could command another toon with Glenn on that second turn to finish up. It's just being able to identify what's going on in the match and how to influence the outcome just with smart gameplay, in my opinion. One thing that I do need to do more of when I attack is use more focused characters, so like Ivanova and Eren, just so that I can place my princess's normalizability more. In this next attack, I'm using a passive attack team. I'm using my payback Negan just to showcase how you can trigger fast rushing defenses to cause like self implosion. Now, I didn't get the desired result that I wanted there. I wanted Arav to rush, and now I'm kind of improvising how this is going to go. Like, ideally, I wanted Arav to rush and kill my Negan in line with Ajax. I'm using Ajax as my shield because he has a natural 150% damage reflect weapon. So it's just a higher chance. So if someone's running Priya on a defensive team, I could end up getting both the payback from Negan if the rampage damage hits him, as well as the reflect damage, which could kill Priya because of Ajax's weapon. So I just like giving myself multiple opportunities to kind of make something happen. Now, I will admit this match ended up going on a lot longer than what I wanted or planned, but it just didn't work out the way that I wanted it to. Arav ended up getting normalized and taunted and didn't rush on the first turn, so I had to do the best that I could. Whenever I see a Mercer lead, I usually go Mercer on Mercer. I like the RNG. We just have Angel here who can exhaust my team, so I'm controlling her on the first turn, and this should give me enough leverage to do a full-scale attack on the second turn, as you saw. My Priya does the most amount of work, and my Mercer helps clean up because he can do damage as well as stun the enemy, and that stunning ability is so important. It just gives me another layer of control, just in case. Now, the only danger on this team is really Arav, so I am going to end up rushing him because I definitely want to kill him. There are no revivers on this defensive team, and it's kind of a safe tune to attack. I know that he's not going to have a stun weapon, impair, confuse, or anything like that. So he's just a safe target, and I don't think Angel had an impair weapon, so I wouldn't have gotten an attack boost from there. That match went by pretty quickly, so I'm happy with that. Whenever I see a Pete lead, this is when I go in with a heavier attack team. I've mentioned this also in other videos, how it's important to lead off against a defensive lead with an attack lead, because you really do need that attack boost to overcome the amount of extra defense that the defense actually has. Not just from a defensive leader, but also from someone being the general. So if the general's still alive, there's a 20% defense buff to all teams in the party. And that's why typically you want your general to be one of your fastest hitters, as well as someone who has one of the strongest defenses. And there's really a few reasons for that. The first one is, if you attack a general, you end up getting more points, but also if you are the general, you score more points when you get a kill. So it's ideal that you have a person who is a very, very strong hitter as your general, but also someone who can hold up on their defensive end, because they are also giving away more points to the opposition. So it's a fine balancing act, because as the general, you don't get the 20% defense bonus, but you do have the opportunity to score more points. So if you think you have a really good defense and you're a fast hitter, if you're in a faction where, you know, you usually don't get assigned general, you could volunteer and ask for general. You'd end up helping out your faction more, because you'd be able to score more points for the faction. So don't be afraid to kind of volunteer and put yourself out there. I usually do not try to get general because my defense is just not very good. Being a free-to-play player, it's made it difficult to acquire the tunes that I need to be a very good general, to have that strong defensive team. So even though I'm not the general on my team usually, I do try my best in order to score well for my faction and contribute a lot of points, both solo points for my individual milestones, as well as faction points for the faction's overall rank. Anyway, thank you everyone for watching and listening to my video. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I hope to bring you guys some more War Film 2 of the next cross-regional war that is the last qualifier for WOC 3.